Hello, everybody, and welcome to this Tech by Design discussion panel. In this keynote, we are going to be talking about how to successfully integrate technology with design. Technology does not have to be ugly, and we argue there is no reason that it should be. Here, we're going to explore the many ways that technology can complement design and even enhance it. So, I am delighted to be joined by a group of esteemed panelists. In order, I have Jamie Briesmeister. Jamie, would you like to say a few words about yourself?
Yes, hi. My name is Jamie Briesmeister. I have an integration firm in St. Louis, Missouri called Integration Controls.
Wonderful. And next up is Pip Evans.
Hi, Jeff. Pip Evans, NV Integration, set up in 2010, high-end residential integrator based in London. We do most of our projects there. Fairly active with CEDIA, member of excellence, previous award winner, previous judge, and current advisory council member.
I'm delighted to introduce Simone Suss.
Hi, I'm Simone Suss. I run Studio Suss, which is a London-based interior design studio working across the residential and commercial sectors.
Okay, and Brian Beeger.
Hi, Jeff. Ryan Biga from Lutron Electronics. I've been with the organization for a little over 20 years, based out of Charlotte, North Carolina, primarily specializing in our residential business during that time.
And last but not least, there's Aaron Gutin.
Hi, Aaron Gutin. I'm an AV professional for over 20 years. Been with Savant Systems for the past many years, managing all of our retail business here in the United States.
Very good. And I'm going to be moderating this panel. My name is Jeff Hayward. I'm the director of Wildwood PR, and we're an agency that's working both across technology and interior design. So hopefully I can keep our experts in order and make sure we have a great discussion. So first up, what areas of home technology really impact upon an interior designer? I thought I could probably come to you first, Jamie, on this one.
Yeah, sure. Absolutely. So you've got them listed up here, and I'll just kind of walk through a little bit about what they are. Audio distribution would be music throughout your house. Video distribution would be movies throughout your house or any kind of video stream that you watch. Lighting control is a great term that people may not understand. It doesn't necessarily mean the lighting fixtures themselves, but controlling your lights in a smart manner, so that your whole house can adapt to how you tend to live. Home theater or home cinema, these would be dedicated spaces for watching movies with your family or enjoying them alone. Media centers would be more of a media room, not necessarily a dedicated space, but a media room that may be open to other areas of the home. Think about kind of a lower level bar area, et cetera. And automated window treatments, which are gorgeous, shades that raise and lower according to the time of day or on a timer, based on where you are in the world, etc. They're beautiful.
Very good. And Pip, it doesn't stop there, does it? We've got another slide.
More to come. So from the top, security systems, that is multifaceted. So that could be an intruder alarm. It could be surveillance cameras. It could be perimeter detection, or you know, as little or as much as Fort Knox as you want to go. Phone systems, potentially really useful in rural locations these days, still got patchy phone signal. People are living more for the country life these days for certain reasons. Gaming rooms, read a stat the other day, gaming is bigger than the betting industry these days. So that's a huge thing. Professional online gaming has obviously huge demand on other factors as well in the house, like the incoming internet, because it's all through the internet. Pool and spa control, I've done a few of these, but not so common in central London, unfortunately. But it's a good point to make that you can interface third-party systems from another contractor or specialist into our system, so that you don't have a proprietary plasticky looking thermostat on the wall. And landscaping as well. So, water systems for your garden, and lots of other things that can fall into that as well. Samsung have just released a new Terrace TV to match the Frame TV. So people looking to spend all of or more of their time outside enjoying some vitamin D. The thing that stands out for me here is that as much as possible, we would look to sort of integrate and amalgamate all of these systems in a centralized way. You hear us talk about centralized versus localized. We're of the opinion at NV Integration that centralized is inherently better for a number of reasons. Perhaps the high level ones are things are more reliable that way. Things are more future proofable that way because things can be easily interchanged. And the servicing and the monitoring of the system is a lot better that way as well. So we advise our customers to have a centralized system, and then that gives us a node zero in the house where everything can go back to, and then that falls into the infrastructure of the house and how everything is wired from the ground up. I would say a very high percentage of our projects are in line with a refurbishment or construction that happens in the project, and then therefore the opportunity to hide all these things and future-proof the house is done at the right time, so at the end it all looks beautiful.
So we're talking about lots of technology coming into the home, and let's be clear, if you want it to be reliable, you want it to work, move away from thinking that everything is Wi-Fi.
It would be a great idea, and I do hear that said quite a lot. Wi-Fi is great. Think about the Wi-Fi as the thing that you want to design the system around as little as possible rather than as much as possible. People say, oh, you don't need wires anymore. Isn't everything wireless these days? If you're streaming Netflix in 4K in a room at the back of the house, then if that's going over Wi-Fi, that's going to have a huge impact on the person next door that's trying to do a Zoom call. If you were to put that Netflix stream hardwired into the TV and therefore not reliant on the Wi-Fi, the person Zooming next door is going to have a much, much better experience. So it's really horses for courses and just getting the design right and doing all the heavy lifting with the cables and keeping the Wi-Fi free as much as possible for everything else that has to be on Wi-Fi.
Wonderful. Okay. And for interior designers to think about professional integrators, Aaron, how would you describe the relationship between the two as you see it?
Yeah, I mean, often this is a relationship that there can be some competition for wall space and for thought processes, but really the goal is to meld into the process, right? The customer, if you think of the integrator as the artist with various skill sets, it's really the customer that's the muse. So how do they live? What is their intent for the project? What's their lifestyle like? What, all the way down to colors and pillows and use cases for the space, really all can fold back into where we put a keypad, what words we put on those buttons, how do we prepare that customer to easily use that space with as few interactions with technology as possible. All of that requires thought process and design, especially because spacing, symmetry, light, lack of light, all of these are things that interior designer, just like a photographer, would focus on. And if you don't think ahead, usually you end up being the person who ruined the wall or took a paint job and stuck a big ugly thing in the middle of it. So you always want to be sort of doing that basic blocking and tackling early on, as soon as you can get involved. Sitting down in that trailer on the project or in the living room with the entire team and really expressing the goal of the project from the integrator standpoint to the entire team, contractor, interior designer, and every other trade, in my experience, goes a really long way when they hear, hey, my goal is to not be seen at all, but to do that, I'm going to need everybody here to help. We're going to need to find space. We're going to need to think about all of these things. And as soon as you can make them your partner, typically the project goes a lot smoother than my AV guy says, I have to put this here. Well, now your interior designer is saying, no, I'm in charge. you can't put that there. So.
Got it. And Brian, lighting, Aaron mentioned just there, but lighting and lighting control intimately connected. And that's a big part of Lutron's business, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's really the core of our business. I mean, we kind of break it up into three categories. Your business. And what's exciting is, you know, how far it's all come, and we'll get into a little bit of that today. But, you know, just being able to highlight the right accents, you know, and create the right pathways and creating all those perfect settings, you know, incredible on the lighting control side, you know, on the automated shading side, being able to, you know, provide something that's ultra quiet with all the hem bars perfectly aligned. And then finally, you know, the lighting fixture side, you know, and with Ketra and Ibalo and things like that, being able to tune light exactly like you want it in any space, all the way down to the fixture level, you know, shifting color temperature as well as vibrancy. I mean, it's definitely, you know, an exciting time, I think, in the design community with what we're providing.
So there's a real connection, Simone, between technology integrators and what they can offer and the technology brands and what they can deliver and what you as an interior designer wants to achieve.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, in an ideal world, the technology is as invisible as possible most of the time. Ideally, we want it, you know, coming from the interior design point of view, we want it to make it all about the design concept and everything else and have all of the functions and the things that the tech are channeling and enabling and have all of that just be invisible so that the client can enjoy it, but we don't have to compromise the design in any way or see it on the walls or see it in the space. So it's an interesting collaborative effort to get to the kind of dream interior, which has the all singing, all dancing tech and all the integration kind of hidden behind a design that no one really realizes what it can actually achieve.
What would you add to that, Jamie?
I completely agree. And having technology hidden also keeps it timeless. Because as we know, products have changed a lot over the years. Some have been nowadays much more beautiful, but being able to remove those interfaces that you would interact with removes any kind of dated look that could be there as well. And by hiding a lot of those products and really it allows you to focus on the interiors and really make the space work for the homeowner and for how their family works. The relationship is critical to have both parties on equal plane and working together for a common goal. Really, it's, you know, the sum of the parts that make the project work well and pull together. And when everybody is working in tandem, rowing in the same direction, you're going to have a much better outcome, typically much faster too.
I'm sure it's the same from your side, Pip.
Yeah, absolutely. Our strapline is integrated home technology. I'd like to think we're very design aligned and therefore, you know, get along well with the designers for the benefit of the project, because ultimately that's what it's about. Simone mentioned that, you know, invisible is the best thing. If it can't be invisible through whatever means, then let's make it coordinated and make it look like it was supposed to be there, color matched or trimless or, you know, book matched or whatever it is. Let's do it properly. And the way that you do that is you start the conversation early. You know, there's no designing at the top of the ladder on a Friday night at 11 o'clock when you're trying to hand it over to the client the next day. Then that's too late. The horse is bolted. So have the conversation early, communicate with the designer, with the integrator, and make sure you're all on the same page and you've got time to, you know, do it right for the benefit of the project at the end.
I think that's a really interesting point. From my perspective, it felt some years ago that there were integrators and interior designers were opposite ends of the spectrum. And today it feels that they're much closer. And certainly, Brian, from a product aesthetic perspective, there are some beautiful products that you guys are making for integrators and designers.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you know, it's come a long way. We know we need to work together and I think collaboration is going to be kind of the topic today. You know, the reality is technology doesn't have to be ugly. You know, at Lutron, we actually have a team that focuses specifically on three key things with everything that we develop. And we work often with the design community to create things and new innovations. The team is called ACE, and it's aesthetics, cognition, and ergonomics. You know, we talk about everything kind of going away and that minimalistic look. Well, some things have to exist, and we want to make sure that the things we develop look the best that they can. You know, it comes down to that coordination, which we're going to continue to talk about between, you know, the designer the integrator. You know, one of the things I wanted to show here was our Palladium suite. I think it's a great, you know, snapshot of some of the things that are out there that the design community may not know about. I mean, this Palladium keypad on the left, laser engraved, custom to the client, you know, nice sharp edges, comes in a variety of finishes. You know, the Palladium shades in the middle, exposed bracketry, you know, extremely minimalistic look with that hem bar, as well as the brackets themselves. And then I know last week it came up on the thermostats. You know, we're definitely looking to coordinate that as well. So this is just a snapshot of one of the things that we've developed as a suite of products with designers in mind. So it doesn't have to be ugly when it has to exist. And we're very focused on, you know, making sure we continue to develop things that complement the space.
Excellent. And now one faceplate on the wall may be beautiful.
Yep.
If you've got multiple faceplates or multiple things on a wall, what's the term that you would use to describe that, Simone?
Well, we would use wall jewellery sometimes, but I do know that other people call it wall acne. But that's really something that, again, it's just so important to cover that off at the start of the project, to know exactly what services are going where and what needs to happen. Yes, exactly. I mean, if we look at this image, this is, you know, this is not what anyone wants, really. We really want a nice, clean plate. We want all the plates to match, ideally, all the plates to be quite as small as possible, you know, to have a thermostat. If we can have a thermostat as a thimble size as opposed to a big main thermostat in every bedroom. So just by exploring all the different options. So as designers, we really need to work well with the integrators to work out what are the best options so that we can minimize the wall acne, wall jewellery, so that the essence is the wall treatment as opposed to the things that are on that wall.
And Pip, I mean, do you want to just expand on that? This, it doesn't have to be that way. It can be beautiful like this.
Yeah. These two images here, obviously completely different styles, both based on an intelligent lighting control system, although the one on the left, you wouldn't think it. This was to meet the needs of a husband and wife who had very different briefs. And the husband wanted to control his lights in an intelligent way. And she wanted to have, you know, that classic look on the wall. And we're seeing a huge trend for that. And thankfully, there are more and more products coming to market which fit that bill, which we can talk to clients, talk to designers about, and find creative ways to put smiles on their faces and our faces and work well together for the good results. The keypad on the right, that's a Lutron Palladium keypad, and it was bespoke matched. I think they've now got that as a current antique brass finish. But the same thing runs through the whole vein for everything, because if you wanted to not destroy the look and the power of that on the wall with a plasticky looking heating thermostat right next to it, well, hey, don't worry, we can incorporate that into the smart system as well. So you see a brass thimble sensor, which is the size of a 50p piece, an American there. You know, it can all run through. There's a range now of Lutron keypads from Focus SB, so we could match the Focus SB keypad with the power sockets. You know, it's limitless. We've just got to know what it is and be working together.
Very good. And in terms of the kind of acne that we're talking about, it's not just what you might see on the wall, but a lot of technology integrators are focused on making it simple, aren't they, for clients to operate, Aaron?
Absolutely. I mean, this is one of the key elements that we focus on at Savant, is not just the hardware, you know, lighting fixtures, color tuning, daylight mode, all of these advances that we've delivered are all paired with an interface inside our application that makes all of this technology easy to use. So even if we think of something like circadian rhythm, right? Wellness is something Brian brought up. This is something that we have been bringing to market for over 3 years. You do not have to be a color scientist to understand how to make your lights shift color by time of day. We boil this down into four simple choices, or our RGB color wheel makes it very simple for anybody to color tune. Now, You want to go deeper? Sure, your interior designer can work to identify the exact hue of light, temperature, intensity that brings out the textures and the hues of that room is a great example, right? That vibrant white we see here on the cabinetry, even though it appears as if that's natural light, we see just a little bit of it on the one side of the screen. Most of that light we're seeing off of those cabinets is actually reflected. So does a customer have to understand this to use their house? We don't think so. It should be as easy as I need to see. And if we've done our job in the background, that button they press on a keypad that says, you know, good morning or lights on should bring that space to light in the most picturesque way we can. So, you know, we're very focused on not just the aesthetics of the remote control in your hand or the keypad in the wall, but also how do you interact with our software? How much time does it take to turn music on? This is something we sort of furiously focus on, time to music, you know, all of those things. These are little tiny fractions, femtoseconds, that do add up over a year. And certainly with more and more single serve devices being popular, right? A smart thermostat I picked up at my local big box store, or a smart thermostat. These things are islands. They only talk to a single app, but customers are more exposed to them now. And this has actually helped our community, right? We have more people who are aware of our of what we do. The impetus is on us to really deliver a solution that goes well above and beyond that single serve experience. And that's something I'm sure Pip and Jamie and everyone on this call is focused on in their own career is how do we tie it all together? And you can't do that without thinking about simplicity. And the common misconception is that simple is affordable, but in reality, simple is really expensive because that single button you're pressing has a lot of stuff behind the curtain, you know, Mr. Oz behind the curtain there making everything happen for you. That's really what Savant does. You know, we're the intelligent sort of guest in your home, constantly ensuring that the things you want to happen are happening when you want them to happen.
I think that's a really good point. You know, to deliver that great experience, you need a professional to help deliver that for you. And just on some of the areas that you might feel challenged on, I mean, the whole kind of way that you work together is really important, Simone, isn't it? And how early that you get the integrator involved.
Yeah, absolutely. I think key with most things when we're building houses or other properties is that everyone gets on board as quickly as possible, and that we have a united vision set by the client, set by the architect, by the contractor, and everyone else, and that everyone sits around the table and works out what the priorities are for the client and then how we work together to achieve those priorities. Because essentially, we need a united vision. Everyone will then work more closely. It's much easier if you can set out the steps of what the priorities for the design are and the priorities for the integration are. And then it just makes everything so much more easy and smooth further down the line because the objectives have been set really early on. And it's like that with most transactions and businesses really, isn't it? So from our point of view, as early as possible in the planning while things are on paper rather than being on site, if we can get all of the integration in and we know what we then need to design around, it just makes everything a whole lot easier.
And I think that way as well, you'll avoid those issues that you might have around budgets, around having to compromise on the performance of the equipment that you might want in the house.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, there's obviously the overall budget. If we're talking about a residential project, for example, there'll be the overall budget, which will be under the contractor, which is for the build, and there'll be a separate budget. And then there'll also be the furniture, fittings and equipment budget for us. And so if everyone can get things down as early as possible so that budgets can be sorted out as early as possible, because the last thing anyone wants is when we're all trying to buy, you know, whether it's the speaker, or couches or anything else that's further down the line, and the client's like, well, I can't do that because the budget isn't there. So I think if everyone can get the budgetary constraints down, you know, even if it's just estimations, just so that we're not fighting and squabbling at the end over our own budgets. It's all about working together, and it's all about being clear and transparent with the client, I think, and with each other, and working out whether the money, you know, the extra however many hundreds of thousands of pounds or dollars spent is worth it for the possibly incremental difference in what the client actually gets in the end.
And Pip, it's worth designers understanding as well that not all products perform exactly the same way for exactly the same price.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, just to add to Simone's point on top of that, the last thing that we ever want, to be totally impartial from a CEDIA point of view, is that the customer gets a bad experience or a bad installation. It benefits no one. We meet lots of clients that aren't having their first smart house, and they know that they don't want that because of a bad experience previously. So as much as possible, we want to be perceived in the first instance, with the time frame allowing, us to be like a consultant to work with them stage 3, stage 4, get the project to tender, get the construction underway. But you know, whether they work with us or whether they work with someone else for whatever reason, the most important thing is that they have a good experience, because maybe next time they do work with us for whatever reason. So I think that's just hugely important. If you were to go onto Google and type in smart home companies, UK, New York, London, and you contacted those three companies and gave them the same brief, you'd probably get a really different outcome from each of them, because everyone's got their own ways of doing things. I'm not saying that's right or wrong. I'm just saying that, you know, for the benefit of the project, you should, as you would with an architect, you would get the foundations of the house laid first in a metaphorical way. So, and then that runs all the way through the design and the product selection, because no two parts are equal. There might be a very specific reason that an integrator's picked a specific speaker because it needed to achieve a certain performance objective for the quality, for the reflections in the room that had lots of hard surfaces. And you know, if you work with an integrator you trust, and you've got to have a bit of trust there to make sure that they're putting you on the right path. I worked with a client about 18 months ago, and he said to me before we were appointed that getting into a relationship, a business relationship, was like a marriage, because you work with that integrator for such a long time, and that is a lasting relationship that we do have with our clients through the ongoing support and aftercare. So that trust in the first instance, and also from us to make sure that we do it right for the client, because it's not, we don't pack up our tools and go away when it's finished. We're there for the long haul, and we have to make sure we do it properly.
Do you think interior designers, do you think clients trust integrators, Jamie?
Do I think clients trust or interior designers trust? Well. Both. You know, I think it kind of depends. You know, in the earlier years of integration, I feel that perhaps we did ourselves a disservice by coming in a little too strongly, us as an industry, from what I've seen, looking at interior designers as maybe foes instead of friends. And that's a really false mindset to have when you're engaging in any kind of collaborative business culture. To me, the importance ultimately is a happy client, right? And we all want the same thing. So if we can all go in the same direction, knowing that we want a happy client with a fantastic project that looks amazing, and everybody is thrilled at the end of it, then we know we did a good job. And that collaborative piece is crazy important exactly for that reason.
So being brought in early, some of the projects that you've worked on, Jamie, where you are brought in early, what does that allow you to do?
Well, it allows us to time things appropriately, for one. For this image here, for instance, are invisible speakers. There's absolutely no way that we could do this after the fact. Running wires after the fact in this home, it's impossible. So timing is critical, but also setting the budget, right? Like having that budgetary conversation. If we're brought in too late, well, then the budget explodes, the timelines get thrown off. We may have to undo what's already been done. It becomes a frustrating element of the project, and no one wants that, especially the homeowner, and or if the interior designer maybe didn't know, then it makes maybe him or her look bad, or the technologist comes in and comes in hot and says, no, this has to be here, and they stamp their foot down. Well, no one wants that either. So timing and budgets, and also having those technical conversations behind the scenes so that we don't have to look at a wall like this and say, well, to get that invisible speaker, we're going to have to cut this and, you know, open up your plaster, and it's going to have, you know, this impact on all the other trades. It's much better to have that conversation as a professional so that we don't have to bother our clients with that later on. Those would probably be the three biggest reasons that I see collaboration working and the timing ahead of so important.
And conversely, Pip, if you are brought in too late on a project, tell me some of the headaches that gives you guys.
It hamstrings your arsenal of product selection just so much. To use a comparable, there's lots of historic AV installations out there in London. Lots of people have been spending time at home recently and decided it's time to refresh that plasma screen. And we've seen some interesting things going into houses of projects that were done a very long time ago. And I look at that a similar way that we would look at being brought into a project too late, where the walls are closed and there's no opportunity to put cables in. A great example, Samsung Frame TV is a great product and interior designers love it. It comes with a huge bulky media box. And if you don't know about that when the wall is being constructed, then the Frame TV sits off the wall by about 50 mil. So it doesn't look like very much like a picture frame anymore. So thankfully we know about, you know, the pitfalls like that can trip you up, and put that on our drawings nice and early, and then the Frame TV goes flush. So that's the goal, and that's the aim, and all of those little things just so important, just for the, it shows in the finish, I think.
And Jamie, Simone talked earlier about collaboration. That's the ultimate goal for you guys, to work successfully with interior designers.
Yeah, I mean, there's really no reason to create enemies, right? Especially when we have the same client. And as it relates to like owning the project or what have you, to me, it kind of depends on who brings the client to you. I have referred clients to interior designers, and oftentimes they look to me to lead the conversation in that regard. And vice versa, I've had interior designers come my way with their projects and their clients, and they lead the conversation. It's actually quite simple if we boil it down and take a step back and both agree that the end goal is a fantastic project.
And we're seeing some fantastic hidden solutions here, where you can have screens popping up out of walls. You can have, I think we've seen so many speakers that we haven't noticed already in some of these pictures where they're actually plastered over. But Brian, you guys as well, in terms of delivering those excellent product aesthetics, that's what you're all about. You're in it together with the integrators and with the designers as manufacturers, aren't you?
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. I mean, you know, as I listen to everyone talk, I mean, to me, you know, it kind of reminds me of what we're all focused on here, and that's really the client as the top priority. I mean, our first principle at Lutron is, you know, take care of the customer with superior goods and services. And I think that's, you know, what our top, you know, residential influencers and our integrators share with us. And I think the only way to do that is to let everyone do what they do best. You know, when we think about the skill sets that are on the project, if we can embrace those and work together, as we've all been talking about, I think that's really the way that we, you know, give that end user the ultimate experience. And having the alignment from a technology quality reliability perspective with the manufacturer, aligned with the, you know, the integrator, as well as the designer, I mean, it can work beautifully. And the best projects I've ever seen, and the best relationships ever built that I've worked with, have been, you know, when all that's in alignment and people, you know, digest, accept, and really embrace the skill sets and let people do what they do best.
Aaron, anything to add to that?
Yeah, sure. I mean, I think we're entering a time here where what we all know as integration is going to change, right? We're faster processors, new advances in lighting and energy, new materials, everything gets smaller and easier. If you think about just a shade motor fitting inside the actual roll, this is something that none of us would be talking about again a decade ago. But now we're seeing wireless motors that we can slip right into Savant shades and mount right on a bracket without really any exposed wires. And that translates across literally every category we work in. We're seeing, again, smaller devices with faster processors that do more things at the same time. I think I just read the next iPad is going to be as powerful as the MacBook Pro, which means, what does that mean for a computer? I mean, this is a very fun thing to ponder, but all of that ends up translating into our world, right? Because we end up doing more with less. And really that's been the goal for all of us for the last 50 years our little slice of industry has existed, right? So since Edison put a switch on the wall and you could have artificial light, we've really been seeking other experiences like that in our home. It started translated to television when we got our first remote controls in the late 70s. I finally remember my grandfather's clicky four button shiny chrome remote control for his television. These are things that are not only our expertise, but they're our competitive advantage, not just what we sell, but making it all work together. And Pip has hit on this, Jamie's hit on this, everyone here has hit on this. There's no single solution for a project. There's lots of ways you can attack a scenario. And I think what separates a good team from a team that's dysfunctional is, and I think Simone hit on this, a great discussion about the path we're all gonna take to achieve that goal, right? Of all those options, what's our path forward? What are the tools available to us? How are we gonna integrate into this environment and honor the space, honor the interior design, but still deliver the convenience that the customer's paying handily for?
That sounds great to me. Simone, you've got to agree with that, haven't you? Closer collaboration, everybody gets along, just challenge that integrator to help you look as good as you can possibly look.
100%. I mean, it's all about a decisive client, ideally, or whoever is acting for the client, but, you know, making good decisions, setting clear objectives, and everyone just working towards the common good, whether it's superior sound, superior light, superior TV experience, whatever it is. You know, our job is for everyone to work together so that we place the client in the center of all of our design, and then we all work together to find the best way forward for that client so that their experience in their home or whatever space it is that we're designing for them is the best experience that it could possibly be, because it looks right, sounds right, feels right, doesn't take up too much wall space, you know, and just works, you know, perfectly and exactly how it's supposed to work. So I think by having this kind of open communication, clear objectives that we're all working to together, that's definitely the easiest and best way for everyone to work, as opposed to a situation where there's infighting and fighting over budgets and, you know, everyone's on a quick deadline and things are going wrong. You know, the dream scenario is that we all work together early on, set the objectives early on, and everyone is clear, budgets are set, and, you know, and that way the projects can be, you know, fabulous and fantastic.
I think one of the challenges for interior designers, Pip and Jamie, I'll come to you about this, is that a technology integrator, so much that goes into a house these days could be deemed technology. Where do you draw the line between what you guys are responsible for integrating and what perhaps an electrician or a heating engineer might be doing? Pip, do you want to go first?
Yeah, there's a couple of things there that Simone said. It all works together, and the integrator's got a very unique role where they haven't just got the audiovisual that they do. It's the audiovisual and then IT network and home automation and everything else that all the other trades are doing that we're interfacing with. For example, the car lift. If there's a problem with the car lift, it's the integrator's interface, the bit that the customer interacted with, that showed them that it wasn't working. And the point there is that they're probably going to ring you first. So if they are going to ring you first, you may as well get involved and hands-on with it as early as possible to make sure that it's as good as possible, to avoid as many phone calls as possible if it doesn't work. So the integrator has a very unique role in a project that not many other trades do. And we always say that we need to know a little bit about everything because yeah, we are very heavily involved in the mechanical systems of the house these days.
As well as collaboration, Jamie, it's all about communication too.
Oh, it is. Absolutely. And I think the term as integrator, I just absolutely love that term because that is what we do. And to Pip's point, we touch so many parts of technology that we can oftentimes people don't know that you can interface with a car lift and have an app that would allow that, right? I've had designers be surprised that you could pop a television out of a cabinet just because they had never seen it before. And so showing ideas, and again, when you're involved early and you can plan everything out, you can show the ideas, get the feedback, and then design something that works for both. When you had asked about heating and cooling and all of those, absolutely. If we're providing a remote thermostat sensor, and instead of having an ugly thermostat on the wall, right? Well, now we have to decide, well, is it the heating and cooling person that's doing this, or is it the integrator? Typically, it's the integrator, because again, they are going to call us, even though the heating and cooling system might be at fault. I've had clients call me and say, my lighting's not working. I'm doing everything to work. And I'm like, have you changed the bulb? and that's okay. I'd rather take those calls. I think that's something too that maybe architects, designers, builders are kind of fearful of. They think that, oh, all this has to be covered in my home warranty, and I'm going to be getting all of these problem calls, and I'm not going to know what to do. And the reality is that we get the call, even if it is a light bulb that's burnt out or something's wrong with the car lift. And we prefer to have those calls. Not too many, but we prefer to take those calls and then field them accordingly. The communication between is critical. That's how you collaborate, is through communication. It's a bit challenging more these days since we can't all meet in person and look at a set of plans together. But thankfully, through the powers of Zoom and other media, we can still communicate and still collaborate and work on projects together. And that's really all it's about.
And technology is evolving. I mean, it's becoming more and more useful to designers. There are so many conversations around home health and wellness and sustainability these days. And technology feeds right into that, doesn't it, Aaron?
Yeah, absolutely. This is really an emerging category, is how we quantify all of this effort internally for us. You know, whether it's our sort of globally leading energy management solution from our sister company, Racepoint Energy, which really has delivered the first energy solution that is completely intelligent, manages your house all day long, is smart enough to know when to switch to battery storage, when not to, the introduction of virtual sub panels. If anybody on this call or watching this has a critical load panel integrated into their space, often you have to determine those critical loads in the trailer because your electrician has to wire very specifically so that those critical elements, heating and air conditioning, refrigeration, essential lighting and electric, is alternately powered maybe with a generator. But we live in a time when battery storage, solar energy, and an intelligent device in the electrical cabinet with all of your breakers can actually create a radically intelligent environment. So wellness for us means a lot of things. It's of course energy, as we just discussed, but lighting and color tuning. I think the next big thing we're all gonna be talking about is CRI, the ability to shift the temperature in the space, not only by time of day to support wellness and your circadian rhythm, but also because Simone spends 85 hours looking at different maroon fabrics, trying to find the exact texture and color that's going to totally align all of the other decisions that she and her team have made. The light in that space plays a vital role. I know we talked about this earlier in the kitchen, where that vibrant 5,500 Kelvin, very daylight temperature was bringing that entire beautiful white kitchen to life. Well, we also looked at a space that had darker tones, right? Lots of treatments on the walls. that may call for a slightly different color. We live in a time where we're able to put a single light fixture in the ceiling and then tune it. And what that really quantifies is that lighting itself has kind of surpassed the basic switch that Edison created over 100 and something years ago. We can't simply turn a light on or off anymore if we also need to tell it to go to these four color values, you know, right? White, red, green, and blue. And so this element of intelligence, this the microprocessor being everywhere and in everything from the watch on your wrist, you know, to the computer on your desk and the phone in your pocket, it's really changing everything. And that actually enables us to start delivering on some of those things we used to just laugh about when we watched the Jetsons, which is a house that actually is morphing and shifting to support you rather than you working to support it. And I'm sure Brian has talked about this till he's blue in the face. Nobody wants to walk around the house at the end of the day shutting off lights anymore, right? We sort of expect it to be more like our car. We open the door, the light turns on. We shut the door, and over a gradual few moments, that light ramps down. Well, your house can do that, but it's not just lighting, right? It's energy, it's lighting, it's natural light, and all of the other things that can contribute to a more vibrant, enjoyable living environment, not just for the eye to satisfy the interior designer's work, but also just the practicality of being able to see and live in the space and feel at home.
And interestingly, now we've all experienced the pandemic, Simone, you must be getting lots of clients saying to you, I need to be doing more at home. How can you help me redesign my space? And technology does play a part in that too.
Yeah, absolutely. I think, you know, the pandemic has united the world in the same issues and frustrations by living at home, particularly. Obviously, healthcare aside, which is obviously the priority, but once we're all in our homes, how those homes work for us. We've gone from doing everything outside the home to doing everything inside the home and everyone being in the home together. So, you know, as an example, I've got three children. I was trying to work remotely. They're all doing school remotely. We couldn't possibly all be in the same room. Thank goodness they've all got their own bedroom. So just being able to have everyone have their own space. Then as I was talking about earlier, having to upgrade the Wi-Fi and upgrade things so that the latest technology, the Zoom, the Xbox, the house party, what everyone else needed, so that could all be delivered without compromising anything, without also then meaning that I had to replaster any of the walls or anything like that. And I'm seeing this with my clients as well. We've had quite a few phone calls from clients saying, well, actually, one of them who's just had a baby has just asked us to come in and essentially build some sort of sensory room for the baby, because if the baby isn't going to be able to go out of the house at all, you know, they're quite concerned about coronavirus. So if they're going to be housebound, then let's make the space as good as possible for every member of the family. We recently put into her son on the top floor into his bedroom. He's got his own space. He's got his own gaming zone plus bedroom. You know, that's all got technology integrated, so that he's got the music system and the air conditioning and the lighting. And I do think that we will probably see a shift from this open plan living that's kind of quite early 21st century. Open plan, look, we don't need any walls, to actually, if we're going to be spending more time at home, I need quiet zones. I want a different zones for where maybe I'm doing a bit of exercise at home, where I'm going to be doing work, where I'm going to be chatting with people. And so I think it's really important that we really think about, if we are stuck with this for another year, let's hope not, but you know, if we are going to be stuck with being in our homes for a bit longer, then what are the best ways that we can integrate our requirements into the homes that we're living in now, whether it's putting up more doors and putting up walls so that everyone has separate zones to work in, or, you know, upgrading certain technology elements. I think it's really important to really think about how we're going to live, because it's so different to how we were living. We were living with doing everything outside the house to doing everything inside the house. Hopefully, within a year or 2 years, we'll all be back to the new normal, whatever the normal is. But, you know, I can't imagine going to a gym or anything for the next 6 months. So being able to just have somewhere to put weights or something in a room that it's not out on display all the time, if that's a room that you're using for other functions as well. So it's really thinking about You know, we always design for our clients, we design what's the function of the space, but that function has definitely changed when we're all spending so much time at home.
And Pip, technology enables many of that sort of multifunctional space to actually work, doesn't it?
Definitely. It really stands out to me out of the so many things that Simone just mentioned are just so heavily reliant on our role as well these days. The treadmill will have a screen on it with an internet connection. The gaming room is obviously network connected to other things in the house. The sensory room will have circadian lighting to add another sense to that space. It's just the alignment these days is just becoming closer and closer, which I think is for the benefit of everyone. In terms of the question, Jeff, I read a stat the other day that Netflix increased their subscriber base by 250 million in the first 6 months of this year. No surprise there. But it just shows that, you know, people aren't going to be tripping back to the Odeon Leicester Square anytime soon, I don't think. So all of these things, they all fall in the cascade into the next thing, because with that greater demand on the internet, with people streaming and working from home, it goes back to the backbone of the network, which was perfectly acceptable for mum or dad or whoever to work from home on a Friday. But now, instead of one person, it's six people or five people or whatever. And all of a sudden the BT line isn't good enough, and that needs to be upgraded. But hey, we're using it 5 days a week, so there's value in that. And Aaron was mentioning earlier that the incoming service will greatly impact the choice he makes for purchasing his next house. It's the most precious commodity that us humans own, isn't it? So it's just totally, totally reliant, and the infrastructure just has to be better and better and better. As the infrastructure in the country improves, and anyone living in central London will know that they spent months digging up the pavements to put fibre to the properties in now. So it's just going to go up and up.
And I think it's probably easier for interior designers and architects to think about, not about technology, but as the impact of that technology, the comfort, the experience, Brian.
Yeah. I mean, you know, a lot of great points. You know, like I think what Simone was talking about and the need for flexibility and you know, as times are changing, you know, some things will go back to what we remember and some things won't. And I think we've got to be prepared for that. You know, I think home comfort, home convenience, all those things are at an all-time high, and the demand is significant. And I think it's going to stay. I think having systems and technology in place that are flexible and can maneuver easily to accommodate lifestyles and families and things like that as we move forward are going to be imperative. You know, Aaron mentioned some great things about where things are going with lighting. We're very excited about Ketra and what it can do to offer that max flexibility. You know, and really the reality is, and what's, I think, exciting for us to be able to give to designers is that we've never, on the technology side, at least in the categories we're in, have had more flexibility options and, you know, custom solutions for what you need to enhance the space the way you want and the way your client wants than we do right now. And it's a significant focus for us as we research and develop new solutions, continue to deliver those, you know, with your clients in mind. And so I think we're in an exciting time for all the reasons that, you know, people already mentioned. I won't go back and repeat them. But we're excited about what we're able to deliver to designers today.
I think it is an exciting future. And I'd like to just wrap up now. It's been a brilliant discussion. Jamie, I mean, what key takeaway would you like designers and architects to have from our conversation today?
Well, to not be afraid of this conversation and that integrators aren't one size fit all, I guess. So kind of two pronged. In my experience, I often hear people saying, well, I don't want to invest in technology because as soon as I put it in, it's outdated. And that's not really true. There are many classic cars on the road that are still operating today. They may not have Apple CarPlay in them. They may not have automated windows, but they're still working and they work just fine. And here, you know, with all of these beautiful images that we've shown, that technology can be hidden and gorgeous or complementing the space, as Brian had mentioned earlier. So don't be afraid of the conversation. That's what the integrator is for, to help navigate what products are available, what solutions are available, and at the same time, ensuring that you collaborate early on and find somebody that works with you to see your vision to fruition. There's definitely many types of integrators out there, and they all have different skill sets. So you might need more than one on your project as well. So I guess a few key takeaways for me. Don't be afraid and find someone that you enjoy working with, because it is a bit of a marriage in a way, and you want to be married a long time. So,
Brian, what about you? What would you say?
I think my takeaway would be continue to educate yourself on the reality of what's out there. You know, I think that, you know, we talked about aesthetics, we talked about, you know, some of the things that are available. And I find that a lot of times designers could embrace more technology and things that are out there if they knew about them. And I think that just goes hand in hand with, you know, the collaboration with designers and with integrators, you know, work with them, you know, force them to show you those options and those finishes that maybe aren't the front of mind for them. And so you can make those best selections and work together to, you know, build the ultimate experience for the customer, you know, both in technology, as well as, you know, visually and in function. So, yeah, keep educating yourself. There's probably more out there than you think that's really going to enhance your design.
Simone, what would you like to throw into this conversation?
I'd like to agree with Jamie and Brian. I think it's really important. I think that, you know, technology, as with all parts of design and construction, they're all evolving so much all the time. And I think, you know, the fact that you can now have plastered-in speakers, all these other things, it really does enhance the design, and it's, which will therefore enhance the user experience. So I'm really keen that, you know, we always will work very closely with the integrators and the whole construction team on using kind of best in class products as much as possible, because that's essentially what we're all being employed to do. You know, people are employing us to give them the best design solution. So I think by collaborating early and working together, that's how we'll all make the best, and our clients will be really happy with us and then recommend us all, you know, and the integrators and the technology. And, you know, everyone will benefit from a very happy client. And so to have a very happy client, we will need to collaborate together.
Good points. Pip, anything left to say?
I just echo the sentiments that have already been made, really, Jeff. I think communication, if I had to sum it up in one word, is definitely the right thing. I quite often say when I'm giving CPDs that to architects and designers that I think of you guys as like great networkers, because you have to deal with so many facets of the project that you can't keep up to speed with the things that you need to know about home technology and sustainable building and all the other things that people like that, the specifiers, need to know about. So have a good network for each individual sector that you do need to know about. Another integrator said on a podcast the other day, it's my job to tell you about everything that you might want to have. I know that you might not want to have it, but if I didn't tell you about it and then we got to the end of the project and you did want it, then I wouldn't have done my job properly. And I think that's a great way to start the conversation. People say, "Oh, that's not for me." Well, that's fine. But I'm just here to educate you, because maybe that would have been the one thing that you really did want. So have good communication. And I always see during the phase of a project, at the completion of a project, if you've had a good team and you've communicated well during the project as well as at the start, it just really, really shows at the end in the finished article.
Very good. And Aaron, leave us with some final words of inspiration.
Yeah, I just want to say, Pip, I've been saying the same thing. Like, our job is, we're a waiter, right? You got to tell the customer the whole menu, everything that's on the menu. You got to be able to describe it. They choose what they want to order, but you know, our job is to offer the menu, because if you don't offer everything, they may not know that this other thing was available that they would have spent money on. And often we're our own worst enemies by deciding for our customer what we're not going to tell them. So I applaud that integrator on whatever podcast that was. That's great. I think the only thing I would add is, like, companies like ours are really investing in spaces and solutions that allow the interior design and architect community to engage with our platform. And so, you know, we're shortly reopening our New York City Experience Center to virtual tours. We have a brand new facility that's been in construction for the better part of 3 years. It's an over $25 million residence that's going to be open to the public for the next 3 years just outside of Las Vegas. And these spaces are major investments for us, just like an integrator would invest in their own facility. And I think the best thing I could say to the interior design community is, you know, just like a fabric or anything else, don't judge a book by its cover. Make sure you engage, live with the technology a little bit. I meet so many interior designers that know basically all they need to know to help, but haven't had any real personal experience living with the product. And I can just say that every time I have interfaced with an architect or an interior designer who is actually installing these devices in their own home, they came out of that experience with a completely new respect for our community. We are really the fifth trade, and it's about time that I think that we stood up a little bit and said, hey, we're here and we're here to help you. And so I would just encourage interior designers and architects not only to continue learning, but to expose themselves to this technology. You don't have to spend $1 million to understand what it's like to have one remote control in your living room. It's well worth it. It's well worth it.
Fine words to end on. Thank you all so much. It's been a fascinating conversation and a great way to set off this Tech by Design event. Thank you.
Thanks, Jeff.
Thank you.